to church, everyone. It is great to have you all here. Make your way in from the foyer. Please stand. We're going to start this beautiful, non-rainy Sunday morning with praising our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. So please stand and sing with us.
Hurting and broken within, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin. Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was brought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Today there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are.
Let's keep singing. Oh. So I've chosen some slower songs than normal. Our next song is King of Kings. I usually like to start with a bit of an upbeat, but I don't know if I was in a mellow mood or something, but they're really beautiful ballads with great lyrics. So please, as you sing it, listen and hear and speak out the words from your mouth, but also from your heart.
Darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from the throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
We might just sway, you can keep playing, Ben. While we wait for the words, we're running King of Kings. We'll just keep the music going. We'll keep the music going. Us to be able to sing. Excellent. We ought to start that song again. Just start from the start. It's much better to be able to sing if you can actually sing the words. Okay, let's go. Start from the top.
In the darkness we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running to
mercy in your eyes,
to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
Freedom, I am free for the love of Jesus.
Kings.
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for loving us. Thank you that we can sing to you. And thank you for lyrics on a screen. Amen.
Amen.
Please take a seat.
Now that was worth waiting for, wasn't it? Yeah, to sing all together. We are God's people. We are his church. Jesus has risen, and so we are his people through his blood. And it is wonderful to come together and to worship him together. So we are going to continue our sermon series. We are looking at what does a church look like as we wait for Jesus' return? What does our lives look like as we wait for Jesus' return? For those who don't know me, and if it's your first time with us today, my name is Margaret Ike, and I'm on the pastoral staff team here at Menai Anglican Church, and we welcome you very warmly. And in fact, in 2 weeks' time, we have a newish breakfast happening in the children's playground, and we would love to give you an invitation. And so please come to the information hub after the service, and we would love to give you one and to welcome you personally into our church. But of course, we have our morning tea afterwards, which is a great way to say hello as well. Also, if you're new with us today at the Welcome Hub, we have a connection card, and this is used widely and it's used well in the sense that it helps us to know that you're here with us. If you're with children, that's fine. If you're not with children, that is great. And so we'd love to know you are here and how we can help you. So these are at the information hub, which is at the end of the foyer. Someone, Lauren Corey, will be there. So will Mill Halskamp, and she'll be there to help you with anything that you need to know about our church. As I said, we are continuing our sermon series on Ready for Jesus' Return. We're having a look at 1 Thessalonians, a letter that Paul, the Apostle Paul, wrote after Jesus' return to a very new, very early church, very new Christians. So there's something there for us to learn over 2,000 years later. And we're also going to hear from Punchy about the Love Your Neighbour projects that we have in our church, because we are on mission together, aren't we? We want to serve our Lord, and we want to be out there in the community. So Punchy's going to help us to see this. And we're also going to share communion together. So it's quite a service. So I'm going to hand this over now, this time, to the family spot, to the leaders of Kidspace.
Hi, everyone. Hi. I'm Jono.
I'm Catherine.
And we've been using the analogies of string recently in kids' space. So we've been doing lots of things with strings. We've made some little circles of string and then done all kinds of things with them. I can't do them. But the kids are doing really good at it. So maybe I should learn from them. But last week, we learned about being tangled in sin, which is pretty easy to do with string. This week, we're going to be learning about Jesus taking our sin upon himself. And so stretching the analogy a little bit. We're going to try trap each other, and we're going to try find today the ultimate warrior. Well, the ultimate thumb warrior. So I'm going to teach you, if you have never learned before, how to play a thumb war. Oh, that rhymed. Okay, Catherine, can I get some help?
I'm scared.
So you put your hand out with the other person, a bit like you're going to shake hands, but don't shake hands because you're going to beat them. And what you want to do is you want to get kind of like that kind of contact, like mid, and then just roll your hands. Ready? You go, 1, 2, 3, 4. I declare a thumb war. And then you just got to trap their thumb under your thumb like that. And then 1, 2, 3, boom, she's gone. And what we're going to do is I want you all to find someone next to you. Maybe if there's three of you, that might be a hard one. I want you to play, and then the winner has to find another winner. And then the winner has to find another winner. If you win, you can get Pringles. Do you want to play?
Yeah, let's do it.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Well, maybe you should say start.
No, they've already started. Ready? 3, 4. I declare a thumb war. Okay, ready? You're going down. Okay. Okay, if you win, find someone else who keeps winning and beat them.
Ask for help.
Okay, if you haven't lost one yet, can you please stand up? Who hasn't lost one? Yep. Good job. You haven't lost one? Okay, guys down the front, fight. Thumb war fight, guys. It's not, no ungodly battles here. Two. Do you want to take some on?
All right, hands up.
Yep. Okay. I'm gonna make like a present and wrap this up. Is there anybody who would like to face off with whoever wins this in the ultimate, the final thumb war challenge? Has anyone up the back won all of them? Okay, yeah, do you want to come down? Come down the front, and I need one come on guys, quick, finish it off, take him. Trap him. Oh, this is really successful. This did not go as planned. Although, to be fair, this wasn't planned. So, pros and cons. Okay, I'm just gonna close my eyes and pick someone. You. Oh, right. Do you wanna come up? Okay, who did I get from the back? Okay, I'm gonna give you guys 10 seconds. All find a partner. And you have to face them. Wow, there's a lot more people up here than I anticipated. There's an odd number of people. If there's an odd number, I'll play. Ready, guys? Okay, quick, find a partner. Quick, ready? Actually, do you guys want to play? You guys play each other? You guys play each other. Okay, ready, guys? And play. I don't really know what to do, so if you like these guys, give them a big cheer. And if you like these guys, give them an even bigger cheer. And if you've won, who just won a thumb war here? Okay, you can't all have just won a thumb war. He didn't get you? I think that's fair. Okay, you're the winner on this side. What you're gonna do is you're gonna face someone on this side. Yeah, we're gonna do the final and then we'll make like a plane and take off. Can I get you two? These are just arbitrarily picked. Sorry, parents, if I didn't pick your child. I love you guys. But do you wanna take a seat? Ooh, I know, that's a harsh decision. I'm sorry, guys. Okay, you guys, can you guys face the side so everyone can see you? Okay, are you guys ready? 1, 2, 3, 4, I declare a thumb war. Okay, fight, get him. Yeah, take him down. Oh, big, reaching over. Oh, he's escaped. Good job. You get Pringles. There you go. Okay, we're gonna head up to Kids Space now. Parents and other adults, hope you have an awesome time and feel very edified and encouraged. See ya!
That's a great advertisement for our weekend away. We're the young and the old, and all of us coming together, being God's people, being our church here at Menai Anglican Church, wanting to be together, get to know each other, to care for each other and to serve each other, and the young and the old coming together in one big group. And that's happening at the end of October. But before we get there, what we would like to do is raise some money so that those who would love to be there but would find it financially hard to get there, and that could be one of their reasons, we would like to help out. So let's bring the fees down a little bit lower, and so we're having a fundraiser. And there are three ways that we can do this to help one another to get to this weekend away. Firstly, we can give an auction item. So the auction's happening next Sunday, straight after 10 a.m. church. So if you have an auction item that you think would be great to give it away, then we have a clipboard at the information desk that we would love you to fill out. Or there is some, there, if you go on the website, you can fill that out on the online as well. Something there to give away. Or you can buy one. There may be something there that you would like to purchase, like you might have three baskets of ironing to be done. Or someone has offered to do your ironing for you at a price. Or you might like to have some sweet treats. Someone has offered to make homemade slices and biscuits. So things like that we are giving away. So you can buy them. And this will help to bring our fees down for the camp, for our weekend away. And the other one is that if you feel that the best way I can do this is to donate some money, then that is welcome as well. And that can happen next Sunday, or that can happen online. So it's totally up to you. But as a family here, as Menai Anglican Church, we would like to have this weekend away and to open the doors to anybody who would like to be there and be amongst us. The second announcement I have is that we have a Women's Discipleship Day happening at the end of August, the last Saturday of August. We have the Women's Minister from St Andrew's Cathedral coming to speak to us. She's opening up one of the Psalms of the Old Testament, Psalm 51. And all the details now are on the website. You can register through the website, $30, or you can go to the information hub and speak to Mel and Lauren, and they were more than happy to help you to register for this event. And that is happening on the 27th of August. And the last thing that we wish to say thank you to as a staff team is we had our planning retreat this week. We went away for a couple of nights together, and the stress levels got a little bit high, so we thought we'd better have a game, and really all tongue-in-cheek, and we had a great time together. So we just thought Stefan thought he'd put a video together to show you something of a game that we played, and and just have a quick watch, only for a minute, of something that we were doing. Thanks, guys.
One.
Two.
Yeah! Oh, I see. What a hit.
How much weight?
One.
Oh my gosh, that scared me. Two.
Three. Oh!
I said
that.
No laughing.
One.
Two.
Two.
Okay.
Yay! Woo!
Yes.
Bonza.
Gross.
Now
it's coming.
Yeah.
Six. You're losing your mound.
I was the winner of that game, and you had to keep turning until at last the shaving cream hit me in the face. So that's why I turned so many times. But it was lots of fun, and it was shaving cream, not cream, so I don't know how Connor enjoyed the taste of shaving cream in his mouth. I'm going to hand this time over now to Punchy Andrew Hartman, one of the ministers of our church here, and he's just going to help us to understand what Love Your Neighbour projects we have here at the church. Thanks, Punchy.
Thanks, Margaret, and I'm going to invite Mark to come and join me up the front. Do you want to give her a clap, bit of warm welcome?
Okay.
All right, well, we haven't heard from the Justice and Mercy team for a little while, and so Mark's part of the Justice and Mercy team, and so do you want to tell us a little bit about what's been happening, some of the activities, refresh our memories?
Sure.
Yeah.
The Justice and Mercy team has been around at MAC for over 20 years, and it was based on the verse from Micah 6, verse 8, what does the Lord require of you but to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. So the team's aim has always been to follow Christ out into the world, serving God and serving others, which of course is the core of our faith. So given that we've been around for over 20 years, there's a lot that's happened in 20 years, But we've distilled that down into about 1 minute snapshot just to give you an idea of some of the things that we've done, which I think has just happened while I've been talking. Breakfast at the boat shed, Sarah talking to some refugees, toys for some children that Daisy Hill did, food for Berkeley Life Centre, and some of the Justice and Mercy team. That was our ministry expo. Making meals. Tear fund at Easter, and we do it at Christmas as well. Share the harvest at Menai. And we were cleaning up Australia. And I look particularly dirty there. And a workshop at Camp One. Emily House, where we collected items for them over time, and our students at World Vision, Global Leaders Conference, and Sarah talking to that NAIDOC interview that we had. Okay. All right.
Yeah, so lots been happening. But today we've got some exciting news, a new name and a new plan for the future. So do you want to fill us in?
Sure. So the Justice and Mercy team have had a bit of a refresh. We're now known as Love Your Neighbour, and I think that term came out of some of the things that we were doing recently here at the church, particularly during the pandemic, when we were literally loving our neighbours, because we couldn't go too much further than that anyway, and we were bringing groceries and foodstuffs, collecting that at the church, and taking that out to people in the community that were doing it tough, particularly tough during that time. And then also, more recently, with the floods up in northern New South Wales, when at the church, in conjunction with Anglicare, we were collecting blankets and sheets and towels to help those in those floods that were badly affected. So, to love your neighbour is actually the second of the commandments, after loving your God with all your heart and soul and mind and strength. And Jesus tells us about this in Luke 10 when he talks about the Good Samaritan. And that could equally be known as the Good Neighbour. And what did Jesus commend him for in that? And there were four things in that. And the fact that he commended him for the fact that he saw a need, particularly when some of the others in that situation who had much more reason to care just ignored the situation. Two, he had compassion. Three, he acted on that compassion with his time and his energy and his money to help that person in need. And four, he followed up. So Jesus tells us through that story that we should go out and do likewise. And it's also interesting to know that science tells us that there is a biological benefit to actually going and helping people and showing acts of kindness, and that statistically we're happier, healthier people when we do that. So perhaps God had good reasons that it's for our own benefit as well as the benefit of others to go out and help people.
Yeah, so it's a great parable worth checking out if you're not familiar with it, from Luke 10, and a really clear example of what it looks like to love your neighbour. And so I'm really excited about this team helping us do that here at Menai. So Mark, do you want to tell us a little bit about how we're going to be able to live that command out, some of the plans for the future?
Yeah. Well, we are the hands and feet of Christ. And we sang that song here recently at 10 a.m., Take My Life and Let It Be. And I love the words in that song. Take my moments and my days, let them flow with ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take thy feet and let them be as swift and as beautiful for thee. So we have so many opportunities here to be the hands and feet of Christ, moving with his love. And to be going out and loving our neighbours that are here in the Menai community in 2234, loving our neighbours in the wider community of Australia and elsewhere. So we have a brochure. We have a new brochure with our new Love Your Neighbour branding. There are some of those out at the hub. We also have a notice board over there on the back wall there via the kitchen, which has some of our ministry opportunities that are coming up from time to time during the year and contact details. There's also a Love Your Neighbour page on our website. And of course, you can come and talk to me. I actually won't be staying around after the service today, but usually I'm out in the sunshine. And there's also Liz Mackay from this service that you can talk to. We welcome any new members, come along, any new ideas to our team. But it's not also about being part of the team either. It's just about when the opportunities come up during the year to actually seeing what suits your life and your circumstances to helping out and doing something for others. And it's such a privilege for here at Menai that we have opportunities to go out and to serve others and to serve our community and also to serve those that don't know the love of Christ. And often that gives those incidental conversations that we can have with people and tell them why we do what we do and that we are doing everything for the glory of God.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks, Margaret. As I said, I'm excited about this team and the opportunities we've been involved in the past and will be in the future. It's worth grabbing one of these flyers. As Marg said, there's contact numbers for different people who oversee just the different activities that happen through the year. And just for example, you might be chatting with one of your literal neighbours in your street and they're doing it a little bit tough and you think, wow, this family could just do something as simple as a meal, a home-cooked meal, and you could contact Leonie Puckridge, who's the frozen meals coordinator. Go around, grab a meal, drop it off to your neighbour and bless them in that way, show that love. And as Mark said, it's that opportunity to love them and as we're doing that, praying that they'd experience God's love through us and come to know and love him too. So I'm going to pray for Marg and this ministry and us as a church that we would carry out this command and love our neighbours. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this reminder this morning of Jesus' words, those two greatest commandments, to love you and to love our neighbours. Lord, we want to be a church that lives that out as a body together, but also as individuals. Help us, Lord, to love you with all our heart, soul, mind and strength, and to love our neighbours as ourselves. And we thank you for this team, the many things that have happened through this church over the years, but the things that we want to keep doing as a church. Help us, Lord, to be outward looking, to love those who are in need, to be prepared to go the extra mile, like we see in that parable of the Good Samaritan. We thank you for the Love Your Neighbour team and the different coordinators of the different things we do. We pray that you'd bless our efforts, enable us to serve people and to do it in a way that honours you. We pray that as we love our neighbours, as we love people, that even more that they would know and experience your love through us, that this would provide an opportunity for them to have that taste of your goodness, your hand, your provision and your love, ultimately, that they would find it for themselves too. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Good morning. My name is Debbie and I'm going to continue to lead us in prayer this morning. So let's pray. From Isaiah 55, verse 9. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. Dear Lord, help us to be people who love your word, who pore over it, and consider how to apply it in our lives. Lord, when we are hard in our attitudes and thinking, humble us and soften us to be children who obey your word with delight, so that we may live in joy and peace. Lord, we pray for the situation of China making threatening moves over Taiwan. We pray that all people involved in these political tensions would act in wisdom and restraint so that these tensions would ease and peace would be restored. And Father, we also continue to pray that peace would come to Ukraine. We ask that your mighty hand would prevail to bring a halt to this conflict. We particularly ask that our brothers and sisters would be strengthened and upheld in their faith, and that they would be a shining light of you despite fear and uncertainty. We also ask that restraint and grace would prevail in Gaza between Israel and Palestine. Lord, only you know how to deal with these situations, so we beg you to bring resolution and a cessation of all hostilities in all these troubled places. Father, we pray for our local schools, that your word would go out in these places through the faithfulness and kindness of staff members, students who are your children, and scripture teachers. We pray that SRE teachers would be encouraged by Christian friends and their own churches so that they would be continually growing in their knowledge and love of you. We ask that these SRE staff convey your gospel clearly and lovingly so that many young people will come to know you for eternity. Lord Jesus, we also pray for the many branches of youth work that's carried out here. We ask that the leaders would be diligent in preparing for the time with the young people, that they would have the energy to continue to enthuse them about your saving gospel and the right words to communicate well. We pray that the youth work and Menai Anglican would bring glory to your holy name. Lord, we pray that Daisy Hill is a great time of fun and fellowship for those who attend. We ask that if there are people who attend Daisy Hill activities that don't know you, that the talks that are given there and the people surrounding them would be a great witness to your saving grace and forgiveness. Lord, we pray that you will comfort, strengthen, and heal those who are hurting physically, emotionally, and spiritually in our midst and in our lives. We ask that you will grant restoration and healing to those who are grieving or hurting in any way. Father, we also pray for those who are in need in our midst. May we be generous and sensitive to our brothers and sisters who are in any sort of need so that we can be a well of life to those around us. Lord, we thank you for our overseas partners, Dave and Kristen, as they serve in Eastern Europe amongst the poorer people of their home city. And we pray that the new vocational skills project for the women will be able to commence soon. We continue to pray for improved health for both their daughters now at home with them and for some important decisions that need to be made for their future schooling. We ask that as they move forward a little at a time to entrust, people would be able to see their helpful and generous motives. May all their initiatives in the community result in gospel opportunities. We also thank you for in-depth conversations happening on their team right now, and pray that this will also bring forth transformed lives. Above all, we pray, God, that out of your glorious riches, you might strengthen Dave and Kristen with power through your Spirit in their inner being. Finally, Lord, we give thanks for the many blessings that you provide us. Help us to be generous to others in need and to support our own church with joy in giving. We pray that this church would be a light of your glory in the Menai area, and that we, your people, would show a loving and consistent witness to those around us at all times. We pray that our offerings to you this day would be used to further your kingdom and your glory. Amen.
Our first Bible reading this morning is from John chapter 15, verses 9 to 17. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other.
The second reading is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 17, to chapter 3, verse 13. But, brothers and sisters, when we were orphaned by being separated from you for a short time, in person, not in thought, out of our intense longing we made every effort to see you, for we wanted to come to you. Certainly I, Paul, did again and again, but Satan blocked our way. For what is our hope, our joy, or the crown in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus when he comes? Is it not you? Indeed, you are our glory and joy. So when we could stand it no longer, we thought it best to be left by ourselves in Athens. We sent Timothy, who is our brother and co-worker in God's service in spreading the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you in your faith, so that no one would be unsettled by these trials. For you know quite well that we are destined for them. In fact, when we were with you, we kept telling you that we would be persecuted, and it turned out that way, as you well know. For this reason, when I could stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter had tempted you, and that our labours might have been in vain. But Timothy has now just come to us from you and has brought good news about your faith and love. He has told us that you always have pleasant memories of us and that you long to see us just as we also long to see you. Therefore, brothers and sisters, in all our distress and persecution, we are encouraged about you because of your faith. For now we really live, since you are standing firm in the Lord. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy we have in the presence of our God because of you? Night and day, we pray most earnestly that we may see you again and supply what is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus clear the way for us to come to you. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. May he strengthen your heart so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all his holy ones.
Thanks, Linda. Well, good morning, everybody. It's great to see you this morning. You can see that we've been working very hard this last week as a staff team. Keeping very serious, got very serious towards the end there on Tuesday night. But it was a good time away, a time where we could pray for our church family and plan, and you'll hear much of that over the coming months as to our next 12 months or 18 months plans. But do keep praying for our church as we move forward, and for our staff team as we work together. We do take things fairly seriously, just not all the time. So let me pray for us as we now jump into this part of God's Word. It's actually a really encouraging little section. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the opportunity we've got now to come to your word. Thank you for this letter written by the Apostle Paul to the church in Thessalonica. And we pray that that we will both understand what it is you're saying here, but more importantly, live in light of what we read here, particularly as we look forward to the return of the Lord Jesus. And we pray it in his name. Amen. Well, next weekend is the famous Sun Herald City to Surf. Every August, more than 50,000 runners turn up in Sydney for Australia's premier road race. Every year, the City to Surf makes the news highlights. The image of the sea of people waiting for the starting gun is a great spectacle. So many people that at the last people cross the start line, the front runners are almost halfway to the end. Now, of course, you always see pictures of people who dress up as gorillas or superheroes, but I'm pretty sure that not many of those get much past the start line because this is not an easy race. Just ask Robert DiCostello. Just ask Steve Monaghetti. This is a hard race. You start in the city and you run along William Street, past Rushcutters Bay, Rose Bay. It's all fairly scenic. For starters, and not too bad, until you reach about the 6K mark, and then the body starts telling you that this is getting hard, and then you hit the hardest part of the course. Who knows what it's called? Heartbreak Hill. A hill that goes for 2 kilometres at a gradient of 1 in 8.5. That is, for every 8.5 metres you run forward, you go up 1 metre. For every 500 metres you run, you're climbing 60 metres. It's a hard hill. Heartbreak Hill is a place where you come unstuck if you haven't been in training. Heartbreak Hill can bring even down the best of runners. Even with superpowers, you're going to struggle to get up Heartbreak Hill. At the 8K mark, it starts to flatten out a bit. Then the course swings south and you run along the coastline down to Bondi Beach to finish. Best ever time in this race, 40 minutes and 3 seconds by Steve Monaghetti all the way back to 1991. Almost matched by Harry Summers, last time it was officially run in 2019, who missed the record by 2 seconds. But most will finish this race in about an hour and a half to 3 hours. Now, why am I telling you all this? Well, being a Christian is a lot like this race. If you've been a Christian for a while, you'll know that that's true. It's not an easy run. And sooner or later, you're going to hit Heartbreak Hill. You're going to hit tough times where it's hard to keep going. Here in this section of 1 Thessalonians from chapter 2, verse 17 to the end of chapter 3, Paul's writing to encourage the Thessalonians because he knows that it's been tough for them. And he wants them to keep going as they face their own heartbreak hill. And he wants them to finish the race strongly. If you remember from the last couple of weeks, this church is actually a pretty healthy church. It's a strong church. The Thessalonians have been running strongly. And for this reason, Paul says, we always thank God for you. You're a model church, strong in faith, strong in love, enduring in hope. Because of the way you are living, the Lord's message is ringing out from you all over the world. But the question is, will they remain strong to the end? Will they continue the same way that they've started? That's what Paul's actually a bit worried about as we read this passage. They've started strong, but will they finish strong? Or will they come crashing down in a heap on Heartbreak Hill? Because he knows that this is not an easy race. He knows the Christian life is a difficult course. And he knows that along the way they're going to face temptations and trials and opposition. It's going to get harder before it gets easier. Will they be tempted to give up? And we see in chapter 3, verse 5, that he's worried about their faith. He's been torn away from them, and he gets stopped every time he tries to get back to them. And so he sends Timothy to check things out. Look at chapter 3, verse 5. For this reason, when I could stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter had tempted you, and our labours might have been in vain. You see, Paul knows that they're going through a really tough battle. This is a really big hill for them to get over. The Thessalonians are facing strong opposition. And even though Paul's with them in thoughts, he tells us in 2:17 he can't be there in person. And he wishes that he was. He wishes he was there to help them defend the gospel, to keep the faith. Because he knows they're facing strong opponents. We saw back in chapter 2, verse 14, they were facing persecution from their own countrymen, just like the Jewish Christians were facing persecution from the Jews. You know, it's funny, isn't it, that almost everyone seems to have something against Christians. I think that's why stand-up comedians love to have a go at Christians. It's an easy win to get a laugh. Christian bashing's easy, and the media love it. At times, it seems more popular to be a criminal than it does to be a Christian. The Thessalonians are copying it from the guy who lives next door. Acts chapter 17, you read the account of how Jason and some of the brothers are hauled out before the courts for the sake of the name of Jesus. And who knows what else they're enduring as they try to live out their Christian lives. Paul says in chapter 3, verse 3, you knew these trials were coming. Remember, I kept telling you that they would come. Picking up in verse 3, you know quite well that we are destined for them. In fact, when we were with you, we kept telling you that you would be persecuted. It should be no surprise. It's all part of the course. But that's not all. It's just the start of the hill. Because there's also temptation from Satan. Paul says, I kept trying to come to you, but he kept stopping me. Chapter 2, verse 18. We wanted to come to you. Certainly I, Paul, did again and again, but Satan blocked our way. No wonder Paul's worried. No wonder he sent Timothy to see how things are going. They're up against strong opposition. Their countrymen are up in arms because of their faith. Satan's attacking them using whatever external pressure he can use to try and get them to give up. All kinds of persecutions to make it difficult so that they'll just say, this is just too hard. And he's also applying pressure from the inside, tempting them, whispering them to them, give up. It's just a lie. It's just too hard. And Paul, well, let's face it, if he really was on your side, he'd be here with you. Where's Paul when you need him? Just give up. In fact, verse 2 in chapter 3, we see Timothy hasn't been sent just to find out how they're going. Paul sent them to strengthen and encourage them. Verse 2, we sent Timothy, who is our brother and co-worker in God's service in spreading the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you in the faith. We sent Timothy to remind you again of the message of the gospel, to tell you that we care about you, to remind you that Jesus is Lord and to encourage you in your faith. So Paul's anxious as he waits to hear back from Timothy. Are they going to still be running strong? Or will Heartbreak Hill have claimed another victim? I mean, you can imagine it, can't you? As Timothy, he comes back and Paul sees him coming, and he's so anxious to know how this church is going. This church that he was ripped apart from just 3 weeks after telling them the gospel. I mean, they only had 3 weeks with them to actually establish them in the faith. How are they going? Doesn't have the internet and emails and all the stuff we've got today. He's got to wait till Timothy comes back. And so he sees Timothy coming, and he says, Timothy, okay, come on, let me know how they're going. And Timothy starts and he says, well, I've got to know. How's this church going? Don't worry, Paul, don't worry. They're doing okay. It's good news. Talk about faith. They haven't budged an inch. Even after temptation and suffering and persecution, they're stronger in the faith than when we left them. They're still living with Jesus as their Lord. They're still strong in love, caring for one another and caring for those around them. They're working hard at it. And they miss you, Paul, just as you miss them. They speak as though you're like their spiritual father. And they send their love. It's all good, Paul. It's all good. Well, Paul responds in verse 6 onwards. And I reckon when Paul heard that report, that's when he sat down and wrote this letter. He was so thankful. But Timothy has just come to us from you and has brought good news about your faith and love. He has told us that you have always have pleasant memories of us and that you long to see us just as we long to see you. Therefore, brothers and sisters, in all our distress and persecution, we were encouraged about you because of your faith. For now we really live, since you are standing firm in the Lord. This is just how it should be, shouldn't it? The Thessalonians are powering up Heartbreak Hill, getting stronger in faith, deeper in love for Paul and one another, and standing firm in the Lord as they look forward to the day Jesus returns. And Paul couldn't be happier. Now we really live, since you are standing firm in the Lord. It just doesn't get any better for Paul. For Paul, this is living. And we get a glimpse of why this means so much to Paul back at the end of chapter 2. Verse 19, he says, "For what is our hope? What is our joy or the crown in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus when he comes? Is it not you? You are our glory and joy." You see, there's no glory along the way for Paul. All he's faced is hardship and persecution and backlash for presenting the gospel amongst the Jews and the Romans and the others that are about him. No, the glory is seeing those that he shared the gospel with transformed and running strong in the faith. And the crown will come when he sees them standing by his side on that last day when Jesus returns. That's the crown that he's going to receive. That is what he looks forward to. That is living for Paul. And that's why he wants to encourage them to be on that stage, each one alongside of them on the last day when Jesus returns. So as he hears this great news about the Thessalonians, he sits down and writes, and he thanks God, verse 9. "How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy we have in the presence of our God because of you?" And he says, "I want to see you soon. I want to strengthen you. I want to add to your faith those things that you still need to know about God, those things that you need to know how to keep going. I want to come and I want to be with you." And look what he prays for them, verse 11. "Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus clear the way for us to come to you. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. May he strengthen your hearts so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all his holy ones." Paul's got the day when Jesus returns on his brain in this letter. It's so big part of the way he thinks. Jesus is coming back. Are we ready? Are we ready? Are we thinking about that reality? Is it part of our makeup? And he wants them to be strengthened in their faith. He wants their love to increase not only for one another, but so increase that it overflows to loving for everyone until they get to the finish line. Paul says that his hope, his joy, and his crown when Jesus returns is that they be with him in the end, that they finish strongly. It's really encouraging, isn't it? What an amazing little section of scripture. But how does it apply to us? I mean, here's Paul writing to this little church in Thessalonica, and he's encouraging them. What does it tell you? What does it tell me? Well, for a start, it's a wonderful model of leadership for us, isn't it? Paul is so passionately concerned for the progress of these Christian friends. He's lying awake at night wondering how they're going. I wonder if you're a Christian leader, if you're like that. Perhaps you're a kids leader or a youth leader or a scripture teacher. I mean, it's awesome that we come week by week and deliver the lesson of that week. But do you really love and care for those that you're actually ministering to? I mean, do you think and pray about them during the week? Do you long to see them growing in their faith, in their love and hope? Because the reality is at some point, each one of these people we minister to are going to face their own Heartbreak Hill. And God has put us there alongside them as their coach at this foundational stage in their Christian lives. But we're not alone in this. One of the things that really encouraged me about this passage, and I'm sure it was an encouragement to Paul as well, is just how well the Thessalonians were going, despite the fact that Paul couldn't be there with them. Indeed, as I said, he only had 3 weeks at the beginning of their Christian lives and was then ripped away from them. But what we see in Paul is a love for the people that he shared the gospel with and a devotion to pray that God, in his absence, will continue the work of growing these young Christians to become strong in the faith. And he trusted that God could do this, even though he didn't know how it was going. He wanted to know that God was still preserving their faith and building them in strength. And it's exactly what happens. God, by his Spirit, is at work in the lives of those that we minister to. And we are co-workers with God in bringing growth to those that we lead. And the same goes for our other leaders at church. Perhaps you're a growth group leader. How well do you really know your group members, their temptations, their struggles? Are your thoughts with them even when you're not with them? And can I say, this is not just for group leaders, this is for group members as well. Are we looking out for each other, helping each other, building each other up? Are we there for when they're weak and alongside them when they're strong? Are we building up one another in our faith, in our love, in our devotion to Jesus, and are wanting to be on mission together? Are we there side by side praying for our brother and sister as they make the connection with those that are around them? Is this part and parcel of what we're doing? Paul here is a great model of leadership. And he gets his model, of course, from the Lord Jesus himself. But it's not just a great model of leadership that we get in this passage. This passage gives us a picture of a church that's going from strength to strength in difficult circumstances. In many ways, this church is a model church for us to model our church from. And Paul is overjoyed to hear about their faith in Jesus and their overflowing love in his absence. And notice this love, it's not just restricted to one another in this little church. It's overflowing to loving their neighbour, which is why the launch of Love Your Neighbour today is so important for us to hear, but not just to hear about that some people in our church are doing, but that we get involved in loving those that are in our community, not just within this family. Taking the opportunities to show love, to be there in people's crisis points, in being there as people amongst our community. Carolyn Hatfield last night, one of the leaders of this ministry, said these words, and I love them. With care and prayer, it may open an opportunity to share. With care and prayer, it may open the opportunity to share. Of course, we want to share the love of Jesus that we have found. Of course, we want our community to know that love of Jesus. But sometimes it takes us to step back and care for the needs that we have in front of us, praying for opportunities that then may lead to sharing the gospel. Love your neighbor is a way for us to not only love one another with the wonderful love that God has got for us, but to overflow in that love, that our love would be there to be able to reach out into the community God's placed us in and beyond. Love your neighbour is getting caught up in compassion and some of the other ministries to the persecuted church through Open Doors, through the Tear Fund to the poverty-stricken parts of the world. So this love your neighbour goes not just in our own community, but beyond with the love of Christ. I love our church. It's so encouraging to meet new people almost weekly in this church family. To hear the stories one after another of people who are caring for others in really difficult circumstances. And how we do dig deep to love the community God's placed us in, particularly in a time of crisis. Be encouraged, friends. Menai Anglican really does seem to be a church where God is changing lives. Generations have been impacted. And Jesus is at the center of everything we do. And so can I encourage you to hear Paul's words here and to keep going in this? We want to see every one of us, look around you, every one of us together on that last day when Jesus returns, to have run the race to the end. Yes, we'll hit our heartbreak heels, but we'll be beside each other, encouraging each other, building each other up as we go along that race so that together we can be there when Jesus returns. That we'll keep growing in our faith, that we'll keep growing in love for one another and for everyone, and we'll endure in hope, knowing for certain that Jesus will return to make all things new. Be encouraged, friends. And let's keep going. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this really encouraging part of your word. So awesome to see a leader so concerned about those that he shared the gospel with, that they would be standing firm, that they would be overflowing with love, and that they would be driven by hope. And Father, we want that for ourselves too. We want to be that church, just like the Thessalonians, that are forging forward even through the difficulty of opponents and difficulty of Satan's tricks and all the things that come at us. Help us to look after one another to get us to that line when Jesus returns. But Father, we also pray that you would help us as a church to be a church that really does reach beyond our own family here with the love of Christ to the community you've placed us in. Please bless the many ministries of Love Your Neighbour and help us to be involved in that as well. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. I do encourage you to go off to the information hub afterwards and to get one of these brochures and see how you can get involved in that. It's really a great initiative.
So my name's Andrew. One of the things Jesus does for us is to, if you're a Christian person, you are running this race. You might not even know everyone here, but we are running together. And if you're a Christian person, one of the things Jesus does on that way is feed us. And he doesn't feed us with other things, he feeds us with himself. We're going to be sharing in the Lord's Supper, which teaches us that we live by the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. It causes us to look back. It causes us to look back to the night when Jesus died, and it causes us to look forward to the day he returns and to look to him right now as he is with us. And so if you didn't get one of these packs, put your hand up and Steve or one of the ushers, there's quite a few, okay, who didn't get them, keep your hand up the top as well, and we'll make sure you get a little bit of grape juice, a little bit of bread here to remember the death and resurrection of Jesus. This is for those who are Christians who know and love the Lord Jesus. If you're visiting with us, if you're a Christian person, then please join us. If you don't trust the Lord Jesus Christ yet, he's not the Lord of your life, don't eat with us. Just watch and maybe spend some time thinking as we eat together. Let me just read a bit of verses from the scriptures as we're handing those out. The Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" So if you'd like to just take a moment to get things ready, to take the bread out, to open up the silver tab, that's a bit trickier, and get the grape juice ready. If everyone could just do that. And brothers and sisters, take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you and broke his body for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. And as we all run this race marked out for us by Jesus, who for the joy before him endured the cross, take and drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of your sins, and be thankful. Father God, we thank you who have received this bread and this grape juice for receiving something far deeper when we come to the Lord Jesus Christ, his body and his blood, broken and shed for us. Father, we pray that strengthened by Christ, we can endure. Father, for those of us who are going through the equivalent of Heartbreak Hill this week, help us to keep pushing forward, strengthened by Christ. And those who are doing okay, help us to use the energy we have to help others. We pray this in Christ's powerful name. Amen. Let's stand and finish by singing praises to our God.
Thanks, Andrew. I was thinking after that sermon, preparing this week, that we needed a song that we sung together. Thinking back to the days of the 90s where you might do a call and response, but don't think we have any of those in our song list. We're going to sing a song called Calvary. Calvary is the location where Jesus died, or one of the names for it. This song, I think, maybe try not to count it, focus more on the words, but says Calvary covers it all. I reckon 12 times we're going to sing that. And I think maybe the thing we need, or some of us maybe need to focus on, is it covers it all, not just part, everything. Do you believe that? Do you believe it for yourself? And do you believe it for everyone here who puts their faith in Jesus? So let's finish with two songs, and we'll start with this one. And I think we've got the words for Calvary. Yeah. I'm getting smiles, good.
The Savior alone carried the cross for all of my debts. He paid the cost. Tell me. through the valley of the shadow of death. Your perfect love is casting out fear. Even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, then whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you are here on earth. And I will be only for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, then whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear?
Like the Apostle Paul received the news that their early church, the new church, was loving, caring, supporting each other, helping others to stay focused on the cross. May we be the same church here at Menai Anglican Church. If you came to tell the message of Jesus, to give to the ministries of our church, then the offertory boxes are on the back of the church, and also the account details are on our website as well. While we're having our morning tea together, why not continue these conversations? Why not we continue to be a church that is loving and caring each other and wanting to speak what it is to be saved by the Lord Jesus Christ? Let me pray for us. Father God, we truly thank you so much that all guilt and shame, new life is given as we focus on the death and resurrection of your Son. And Father, may we continue to learn of what it means to be your church here in these last days as we wait for your return. Father, continue to give us your spirit so that we can endure, so we can run the race, And that, Father, may everything that we do in love and deed towards our neighbour, towards each other, be for your glory and for your word to go out. In Jesus' name, amen. So please enjoy coffee and tea outside, and the morning tea team have got some scrumptious sweet treats for us all. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks.